Loretta was standing at the sink in the basement kitchen at HQ, her hand deep in a 20-quart stock pot, scrubbing out the last of the grits, when Marla Lampkins came in from wiping down the breakfast tables. The heels of Marla's boots tick-ticked like typewriter keys as she made her way across the jelly-smeared tile. Take away the dirty towel thrown over her shoulder, and she looked like something out of a fashion magazine, with her mini dress and her high-heeled boots and her sky-high hair. "Getting down to the nitty-gritty, huh, Mrs. Tibbetts?" Marla said. "I guess you could call it that," Loretta said, not looking up. "Actually, I was riffing off something from Bobby Seale. He said, if you want peace and freedom, you gotta get down to the nitty-gritty and don't miss no nits and grits. I think about that a lot when I'm down here, how it's all the little things we do that build the revolution. I tell you, from what I've seen and heard today, the Black Panther Party does more quoting of scripture and verse than a Baptist preacher in a month of Sundays." Loretta turned the pot over, pouring out the milky water into the sink. "I thought it was just my husband talk like that all the time, quoting brother this and sister that and chairman who all." Marla took the pot from her and began to dry it with a towel. "There's a lot of wisdom to be gained from memorizing the words of great leaders." "I suppose. My husband sure thinks so, anyhow." Loretta turned to inspect the floor. "You all got a mop around here?" "In the closet by the icebox over there." Marla pointed out a niche hung with a fading green striped curtain. She asked, "So, are you thinking of joining the party now?" Loretta hefted up the mop to keep the rag ends from dragging on the floor as she returned to the sink. "I'm thinking on it. My husband says there's a lot of things I could do to help." She turned the tap and let the water run until it was hot enough to steam, then filled the bucket. Marla was looking Loretta up and down, with her head cocked to one side and her eyes narrowed. She straightened up and said, "There is a lot you could do to help. If you can commit to helping cook for the breakfast program 3 days a week, that would free me up to take on more sector organizing in the neighborhood." Loretta set the bucket down on the floor and plunged the mop into it. "Actually, I was thinking about joining the leadership committee." Marla made it sound like she was choking on a drink and then snorted, like whatever she thought she was holding back might still come shooting out her nose. "The leadership committee," she said. "That takes time. You have to get to know the organization, our principles, what we stand for. The party is a solid, established thing with structures and rules and relationships. You can't just walk into a leadership position." Loretta looked up from mopping long enough to make sure Marla was following her and said, "Seems to me people have been walking into things, solid, established things they don't know nothing about, all the time." Marla's lips parted and closed again. She looked toward the sink. The faucet had let loose a drop of water every few seconds since Loretta filled the bucket, and now Marla went to it and turned it off with a yank. "Well, all right," she said. "You go ahead and nominate yourself then, and we'll see what happens." "How do I do that? Nominate myself?" "John knows," Marla said, turning to leave. "You should ask him." I want to read one more interaction between two women in the book. So Loretta and John have four kids, one of whom is Jonquil's mom, Gloria, who I miscited earlier. And one of them is Bibi, who has grown up from that Black Panther story to become a court bailiff, and she is working at the Milwaukee County Courthouse. She recently got fleeced by her boyfriend of 2 years, Jared, who basically emptied her bank accounts and left. And so she's in sort of a financial recovery moment where she needs to like find money. And at that moment, the court system says, anybody who can demonstrate a proficiency in Spanish, like a high school proficiency, we can give you a little bonus this year because we really need extra Spanish-speaking help in the courthouse. So she's like, okay, I'm on that. I'm gonna brush up on my high school Spanish. And in the middle of this financial crisis, she accidentally bounces her rent check. So this scene, her landlord, who is a lesbian Mexican-American woman named Natanya, comes to talk to her about the bounced rent check. And this is a little bit of my linguistic wonkiness. It's gonna go into Spanish grammar. So Natanya's on the porch. It's cold. It's like January. So I came to find out about the rent. There was kind of an issue, you know? Yeah, I'm sorry about that. You want to come in? It's cold out there. Bibi opened the door so Natanya could step inside and gestured toward the couch. Natanya was shorter than Bibi, and her sharp eyes and tapered chin combined to give her an impish look. You're studying Spanish? Natanya asked. She bent down to pick up the CD cases and book lying on the living room floor. Yeah, Bibi said as she sat on the edge of one of the armchairs. Trying to anyways, but I can't seem to follow Senor Montes and Senorita Castillo's directions to the farmacia, so I'm just letting them talk among themselves. They both stared at the place on the coffee table where Natanya had neatly stacked the discs on top of the book, as if maybe Senor Montes might have something to add. Then Natanya said, I got a notice from the bank. Yeah, I'm sorry. I forgot I had written a check for a new washer, and then the rent check bounced, and thing is, I won't have any money for you until next Friday. Natanya pursed her lips and said, that's the 15th. It should be okay. I can make that work. I'll just have to move some things around. It's just, this can't be an ongoing problem, right? Oh, no, Bibi said, waving both her hands at the thought. I promise it won't be. I'm not like that. I'm just getting back on my feet after a bad breakup. I let this brother pull the wool over my eyes and, well, you probably don't need the whole story. No, tell me, I'm interested. Natanya leaned over, her elbows on her knees, her open face to Bibi, ready to listen. Really? Bibi said. And when Natanya nodded, she asked, can I get you something to drink then? A beer? A beer would be great, thanks. Natanya started to get up to follow Bibi into the kitchen, but Bibi said, it'll just be a second. You can stay there. Bibi returned with two beers poured into glasses. I like your sweater, she said as she set Natanya's glass in front of her on a coaster. Natanya looked down and ran her hand down it, a trim sweater with gray and white vertical stripes. Thanks. It's really old. It was my dad's. He used to be a sharp dresser. He thought he was a real ladies man, you know, until Mama got a hold of him anyway. I know all about the ladies men, believe me, Bibi said. I don't know how I end up with these guys who still got something to prove. Natanya shook her head sympathetically but didn't comment, so Bibi went on. Like Jared, the breakup I mentioned, he was seeing someone on the side, and from the looks of what he did to my bank account, he loved the slots more than he loved the both of us. I'm working with the credit counselor trying to fix the mess he made. Bibi looked down at her hands and picked a spot of dirt out from under her thumbnail. I'm not making excuses, but I feel like I have to level with you. I totally misjudged Jared, and I'm paying the price, and I'm trying to make sure no one else has to. Bibi held her breath. Natanya seemed nice enough. She wanted her to trust her. It's going to be okay, Natanya said. She raised her glass and motioned to Bibi to do the same. Here's to ex-boyfriends, and to better luck next time. They took a drink, and Bibi asked, so we're straight? Straight? Natanya asked. She smiled and raised her eyebrows like Bibi said something funny. Straight. We're good? Next Friday's good? Yeah, we're straight, Natanya said, with that bemused look again. Hey, you know, I used to tutor kids in Spanish at the high school. I can help you if you want. She was turning her glass in her hands as she spoke. For how much? Bibi said. For nothing. I'm always glad to help someone learn Spanish. It's important. You can say things in Spanish that you can't say in English. Did you know that? Like what? It had never occurred to her that English might not be enough. Well, like, let's say you're on a date, a first date, and you went to the movie and dinner and you talked in the car and now you're taking her back to her house. Her? Natanya opened her hands. It looked like a gesture of surrender, ending with a shrug and a nod. Hey, it's okay, I'm not judging, but if you're talking about me, you mean him. And he better be dropping me on my doorstep and not the other way around, because he got the keys to a car that ain't his mama's. I've done that driving the man home thing before, and I am through. Well, okay, then I'm on this date. With a woman, okay? Natanya pauses as if giving Bibi time to protest. Go on, Bibi said. You're on her doorstep. What can't you say in English? In Spanish, we have the subjuntivo, the subjunctive mood, It means we accept that we're not in control of every situation, that a lot of what happens is in God's hands. We use it when we don't know how the other person will react to something we do, like say that I tell a stranger to do something, then I say it in the subjunctive mood because how can I be sure if he'll do it just because I say so? Who am I to him? And what about this hot number you left at the door? Well, to her, I would say in Spanish, de ventre. See, de bo means I should or should I, but de va means I'm not sure if you want me to come in. We had a really good time, we laughed at the same parts in the movie, you like salsa dancing and martinis, I think you like me, but I don't know if you like me, so I'm not sure what you want me to do, standing here tonight on your doorstep where it's so cold. And entrar means to go in, Phoebe added. Right, and it's raining out here, but only on me for some reason, Natanya continued. She mimed opening up a tiny umbrella over her own head and tapped her foot a little bit, waiting for this imaginary woman to make up her mind. So still, I don't know whether you want me to come into your house where it's warm and dry and where I'm sure I would be much more comfortable. Natanya ended her appeal with a sheepish, hopeful grin. She was cute, Phoebe thought. She reminded her of that guy from the silent movies, short with that dark hair and a lot going on in the face, Charlie Chaplin. She shook her head at Natanya's clown act and smiled. I get it. Subjunctive means not having to guess what everybody in the room is going to do all the time. Lord knows that would be a relief. I need me some more subjunctive in my life. They looked at each other for a moment, and then Phoebe finally let herself settle back into her chair. She had been sitting on the edge the whole time. What are you thinking about? Natanya asked. Phoebe said, I was thinking about other ways to say that, that we don't know what's going to happen. I was thinking about my grandparents who came up from Mississippi and how they used to say, we'll be at your house for dinner on Thursday, good Lord willing, and the creeks don't rise. I never understood that when I was little. I was like, what creeks? And then I got older and I noticed we're surrounded by them, those creeks. Thanks. So there are a lot of different voices in the book. If you hated the three that you heard for that you heard, there are many others that you can try. When they did the production of the book, for some reason, some poor intern at UW Press had to count all the characters, and she's like, "You did 99." So I'm sorry, it's not my fault. So check it out. So I was recently invited to write a poem about the Orlando massacre, so little tears maybe, and it will be appearing in a couple weeks in Glass Poetry Journal's special online Orlando issue, so you can check that out. But you heard it here first. So I have a poem about Orlando, and then I'm going to do one about Odysseus and Penelope, and then I'm going to surrender the mic. thank you for listening. I'm not going to break out the performance art or anything. So this poem, after the massacre in Orlando, I was just feeling devastated for days. Like I just kind of stared at the wall for a couple days. But when I came out of that, I realized that being LGBT or T or Q is a lot of work. There's just work that you're constantly doing, navigating situations and dealing with your own self-acceptance. And it's work. It's a project that you're doing every day for your entire life. And so I wanted to acknowledge the work that all the people who walked into that club that night had done to be at that point where they were gonna go out and dance. So that's what this poem is about. Called Ours. We fought to have even this heartbreak, this neon sign bleeding out its gas, these broken windows. We dug into the flesh, this flesh, to find the God-sprung magic of ourselves. We were ourselves. Call us nothing but that. I Luis. I, Omi. I, Edward. I, KJ. I, Amanda. I, Mercedes. I, Martine. I. How we fought to have this, these names, these dances, yes, even these bullets. We didn't intend to claim those last, but the world insisted we name them ours, our bullet, this one here in the heart between his rainbow dog tags and his shoulder sculpted with the effort of sculpting himself. How we fought not to die. How we wrestled with our own razor, our own starvation, our own bottle, our own cliff, our own bullet. Listen, the DJ is choosing our victory song, the one that rumbles with our nightly triumph over all these ways to die. When you find us dancing, do you recognize the words? It goes, this is ours. This is ours. This is our victory over you. I realized when I wrote this poem that I wrote another poem about young black men I knew who had been killed, and I was just like, I want to stop making the poem with a list of names, you know? I want to stop making that one. So I'm going to leave you on this note. The Chazen Museum in Madison occasionally asks groups of poets, like a dozen poets at a time, to come in and check out their new exhibit, and then respond in poetry, and then there's a night where people come and read. It's called The Bridge. And I was asked very, very happily to respond to Romar Bearden's collage and watercolor series about Odysseus. And he took all of the characters in this epic and turned them into African-American faces, because he said he wanted the children of the Black South to see themselves in this kind of heroic, kind of crazy ancient tale. So I did notice, though, that while Romar Bearden was trying to bring in the faces of African Americans, he still didn't give much space to Penelope, Odysseus's wife, who waited for 20 years for him to show up. And she had a lot of marriage proposals and a lot of people saying, oh, he's dead, so, you know, why don't you just give me all your land and marry me? And, you know, but she kept saying no. But I thought, even though she was, you know, she's held up as like this faithful model, you know, of the patient wife waiting for her husband to return, that she probably was still a little pissed when he got home. It's like, where have you been for 20 years? That's a long time. That's a whole, like, raising teenagers, you know? It's like, that is a long time. So I wrote this poem for Penelope. And Odysseus, I found out from Romar Bearden, means trouble. That his name literally means trouble. So this is called Ego Trouble. I'm doing it like the kids do, reading it. I married a man whose name means trouble. So all this was to be expected. When people asked, I told them, my husband has strayed. How else to explain away 20 years, each day unmoored in the market, on my arm an unfilled basket, the strap embossing me with the crisscross of rope? I don't want to hear about your sirens. Let me tell you about sirens. A table of sweets, streets of open doors, and boys thrusting their honeyed hands through my window, busting in to eat your dinner. Men are never full. Sirens aim straight into the echoey holes of their chests, and oh, the pretty resonance. My advice to wives is this: wait the hull. Fill the cup. Left empty too long, he will top them up with blood. Look at Odysseus's ocean now, a marrow soup, well salted. I've been weaving your shroud. You were not the only thing I was burying at my loom. The shuttle cocked, the sinewy fiber snake tight around my fingers. I promised I would marry one of the honey boys when I was done, but each night I unhooked my work, tied the trailing thread to our bedroom door and slammed as if pulling a rotten tooth. Then I walked the frigid halls unraveling, unsure if you should be dead. Here, I'll sing you a different song. My parched throat, the remote skin vibrated with your absence. In your absence, my tissues hummed. Hummed hard until the sound took on flesh. A bird perched in our olive tree louder. Until the whole sky moaned with bird song. Every long day and blameless night, all the cloud-whisked mornings, every star punched sleep until I resolved to kill it. To crush its neck with my knee. I put the bird in a box, locked it down with magic, carved on it Penelope, then swallowed all the keys. The keys became a cage of bones around my heart, ribs of my own making, so that when you came back, you wouldn't find me waiting.